I'm convinced that every single fish is about to come. Every soul is about to come in the obedience of the voice of God. Hallelujah. And you may think that I've already reached out to people, I've already done what I could do, but I'm here today to tell you there are more fish in the lake. Come on. John chapter 14, and let's start in verse 11. It says, "Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very works' sake." How many know Jesus is in the Father, and the Father is in Him? How many know that Jesus is in us, and we are in Jesus by faith? Come on, somebody. Jesus is in us by the Holy Spirit. Now look at verse 12. "Verily," or "truly, truly, I say to you, he that believes on me, the works that I do," he says, "I do the works because I'm in the Father." And he said, "the works that I do," because you're in me, come on somebody. It says, "the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works," or greater things. Everybody say, "greater works." "Greater works shall you do, because I go to my Father." So in other words, we are supposed to be doing even greater works than Jesus. Oh, did you hear that? I don't know. Sometimes I think, you know, that's just almost hard to believe. I mean, the Word of God says that we're supposed to be doing greater works than Jesus. Well, how many know it says that Jesus was only doing what the Father told him to do, and that he was in the Father, and the Father was in him. And it says we're in Jesus, and Jesus is in us. Come on. Then we are to do even greater things than Jesus. Glory be to God. I believe we're living in the last days. I believe we're living in the greatest end time revival that the world will ever see. I believe that people are going to, I'm talking about believers. I'm talking about born again believers are going to begin to find out who they are and the authority of the believer, and they're going to begin to believe the word of the living God, and they're going to begin to pray over the sick, pray over people, see souls won, see miracles, be in the right place at the right time for God to use them. Come on. I want to be used of the Lord. I want to bring glory to God. Come on. And the only way we're going to bring glory to God is if we do His work. Come on. I believe God wants us to do His work. I believe God wants us to do greater things. Come on. Hallelujah. You know, when you think of the word charis, it's the word for gift. It's more than that. It's the word favor. Charis, that's where you get charismatics. Charis is really the empowerment of God to do the things of God. And I don't know about you, but I want to do the things of God. Hallelujah. We're His children. We're the children of God. And we should do things like Him. We should be like Him. When we pray, we should see results. When we do His work, we should see great things happen. Come on. We're not just sheep trying to get by. Yeah. We're more than conquerors. We're overcomers in this world. The Word of God says we're not just, you know, going about doing this and doing that, and some glad morning we're going to, you know, finally get our act together. No, some glad morning is when you got saved. I said, some glad mornings when you got saved. And when you got saved, it's time to get radically saved. I'm not halfway saved. Not just well. You know, and sometimes I think the enemy works on you and me and everybody in such a way that we believe a lie. And we begin to believe, well, we can't do that. And we can't, you know, we're unworthy. And how could God use me? And I'm here this morning to tell you, it's by the blood of Jesus Christ that made you worthy to stand in the midst of whatever's going on in this world and stand with the name of Jesus and do things for Him and do His work. Hallelujah. It's by the blood. It's not by your good works, lest any man should boast. It's by His work through you. It's by doing His will. And you say, well, how do I know His will? His Word is His will. Amen. It's His last will and testament. It is His Word for you. It is His Word that will rise up inside of you and change you and literally make you like Him. We're being conformed into His image by every time, like a mirror, we see Him and we see ourselves. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. We're supposed to be imitators of God, not imitators of devils. Amen. Imitators of God. That's what it says. We're to be like Him. We're to walk like Him, talk like Him, do things like Him. People should see Jesus in us. We are ambassadors of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Everywhere we go, we should be, you know, people should say, you know, there's something different about you. I don't know what it is, but there's something different about you, and I like it. And you look up and you say, Jesus. Yes. Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, if you just get a lot of the Word in you, and you just keep getting that Word in you, how many know He is the Word? And the Word will manifest. You see, whatever you put in you, that's what you are. Amen. If you keep putting the wrong thing in you, well, then that, you know, then you're going to be struggling. But if you keep putting the Word in you, glory be to God, you are going to walk like Him, talk like Him. If the words that come out of your mouth, whatever you put in you, it says out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you keep putting the Word in you, you're going to speak the Word. Come on. Hallelujah. So we've got to begin to believe this Word. And charis literally means the empowerment of God. This empowerment for greater things. It's time for greater works. It's time for us to do great things. We might be common clay jars, but we're carrying the glorious treasure of God. Are you hearing me? It's time to believe that we're more than just, you know, we may be just a vessel or clay jar, but God looks down at us and He says, you're the apple of My eye. He says, you are My tabernacle. You are the temple of My Holy Spirit. Will you not rise up in Me? Don't rise up in yourself. But will you rise up in Me and do greater things? Turn with me this morning to Acts chapter 4. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Acts chapter 4, and let's go over here to verse 13. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, how many know Peter and John got bold? Oh, hallelujah. You know, Peter, you know, before the day of Pentecost, Peter was kind of a mess. He's a fisherman. He's just a good old boy. And, you know, he's denying Christ and I mean, you know, the things he wants to do, he's just messing up with. But suddenly, boldness. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. How would you like to be remembered as being unlearned and ignorant? I mean, literally, well, you know, Peter and John, I mean, those are ignorant people there. I mean, we're talking real dumb. I mean, we're talking ignorant men here that just, we can't, and it says, and they marveled. And they marveled because they were not Pharisees, Sadducees. They were not, you know, any type of priestly order. They were laymen. At this stage, they were just common folks. They were common, literally common clay jars. Come on, somebody. But they were speaking. Yeah. They were speaking the Word with boldness. Everybody say boldness.
Boldness.
There's something that comes on you when you've been with Jesus. There's something that comes on you that literally you begin to speak the word with boldness. And they began to speak the word. The enemy wasn't holding them back anymore. And literally it says they were unlearned and ignorant men, and they marveled. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. People should know that you've been with Jesus. People should see it on your face. People should know that you've been to church. People should know that you've been reading your Bible. People should know, come on, there's something different about you. Come on. Amen. Glory be to God. It says, verse 14, and beholding the man which was healed, standing with them. I mean, Peter and John just prayed for somebody. And they could say nothing against it. I mean, he's healed. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men? For that indeed a notable, I mean a big miracle, has been done by them and is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we can't deny it. You know, I've always loved it when I've prayed for somebody and there's a miracle and nobody can deny it. I mean, you know, when that girl's leg was all crippled up and it came popping and snapping and it came out straight. I mean, you could not deny that. Come on. The girl with the big cyst on her foot, I mean, that cyst was so huge. And she had it her whole life. I mean, the thing had been there and the doctors wanted to take it off because it had gotten so big. And it just disappeared right there. I mean, it was undeniable. Come on, somebody.
Hallelujah.
Well, I don't believe in miracles, Pastor Jeff. I don't believe in miracles. Hang around. Glory be to God. Why? Because we serve a miracle-working God.
Hallelujah.
I mean, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I mean, he knows how to do a miracle. Hallelujah. He's not up in heaven sleeping. Amen.
Amen.
But you know, there are a lot of Christians sleeping. And there's a lot of people who say, well, God doesn't. How many know you've got to believe that God still does it when you pray?
Amen.
You got to still believe that God's a good God and that he's a miracle-working God.
Amen.
But you start believing. I mean, it's hard for me not to believe it because I've seen thousands upon thousands of miracles in my ministry. It's just too late. I said it's just too late.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Well, I prayed for somebody one time and they didn't get healed. Well, did you believe they would be healed? No. Well, you got what you prayed for. Yeah. Well, I was hoping. Well, hoping, that kind of hoping is not faith. Faith is praying and believing. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
And so we've got to begin to believe God's word. And we've got to get bold. We've got to be changed to the point where people take notice. Come on. And they were taking notice of Peter and John. They said, we don't know what we can do with these guys. But that it spread no further among the people, let us strictly threaten them that they speak thereafter with no man in the name of Jesus. There's something about the name of Jesus that you just better not say it. I was watching these hearings this past week and got to get little glimpses of them, and they have the chaplain there for the Senate, and the chaplain said some pretty good prayers, but he refused to say in the name of Jesus. Now, how many know there's a world today that doesn't really mind, well, they do mind, but they'll put up with a prayer. They'd prefer if it was silent because they really don't want to hear it.
Right.
But you better not say the name. Because there's something about the name. There's power in the name. I said, you got to believe there's power in the name of Jesus. You got to believe there's authority in name that has been delegated to you in that name. Come on.
Amen.
Glory be to God. You are the children of God. And you've got to begin to know who you are and what you have. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Ooh, hallelujah. They've been spending time with Jesus. Turn with me over here to Luke chapter 5. When you start spending time with Jesus, you're going to do greater things.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Luke chapter 5. Let's just start in verse 1. Thank you, Lord. Luke chapter 5, verse 1. And it came to pass as the people pressed upon Jesus, to hear the word of God. Big multitude by the seashore. He stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. They'd given up. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat there and taught the people out of the ship. Glory be to God. How many know Peter had a front row seat? Verse 4. Now when he had left speaking, Jesus said, it was done. He said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a big catch. Hallelujah. Now, Peter had been out in that lake all night long. And he had, it says he had toiled all night. How many know that toiling is part of the curse? Yeah. And the Word of God says that we're actually supposed to rest in God and begin to do things by faith, amen, not by toil. Now, we'll just read that. It says, and Simon answered to him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Duh. You've been toiling all night and you got nothing. Well, why'd you get nothing? Because you did it your way and didn't include God.
Amen.
When you include God, you're going to see results. We've toiled all night and have taken nothing. Now, this is the smartest word that Peter has said. Nevertheless. You've got to have a nevertheless inside of you. You've got to say nevertheless when God says for you. I mean, when you know there's no more fish. You are positive there are no fish in that lake. But nevertheless, Lord, if you tell me to do this, fine. Oh, don't look at me like that. You've been that way so many times where you just know it's not going to work. But you know the word keeps telling you to do it, and your word keeps telling you to do it. Okay. I'll do it. I'll do it your way, God, but I know it doesn't work because I've been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. And that's it. That's how Peter was. He's like, Jesus, you're not even a fisherman. I've been doing this my whole life. There's no fish. Nevertheless, at your rhema word, I will let down the net. Now, how many know Jesus said, let down your nets, plural? Yeah. Peter said, I'll let down my net, singular. We will obey God, but not all the way. I'm going to live for you, Lord, tomorrow. I mean, right now I'm busy. I mean, I got things to do, and I'm trying to be used of you, Lord. The Lord's saying, where? When was that? The Lord's saying, I'm speaking, but you're not listening. He said, I'm in you, but you got to be in me. Be in my word. Because as if you're in me and you're in my word, oh, you're going to do exploits. Come on, you're going to do exploits.
Hallelujah.
You're going to bring glory to God in your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. So he said, I'll let down my net. Literally, that's what's called a test net. It's a smaller net. It is not as big as the big nets. Fishermen, even to this day, will have a test net, and they will throw the test net over. And if there's fish there, and if fish come up in the test net, then they'll throw over their big nets. They're not going to throw over their big nets first, because then they got to clean them. They got to haul them all back in. They got to fold them all up. They got to, and everybody has already been done washing their nets. And so suddenly Peter says, I'll let down my test net. Verse 6, and when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes and the net broke. Duh, again. You do not need the word great and multitude in the same sentence. In the Greek, if you look at multitude, it means thousands and thousands. But when you put the word great with the word multitude, it becomes a number that cannot be numbered. That means every fish that was in the lake came to that boat. That means that boat was, it might have been blue water. It may have been the most beautiful. It may have been so, not any indication that there was a fish anywhere. But when Jesus spoke, every fish in the lake came into obedience.
Hallelujah.
And those fishes, they all came to that. But it went from blue water and it was solid black from the, just fish. Come on. I'm talking about every fish in the lake came to the voice of God. You might be convinced this morning that there are no fish in your life. You might be convinced that there are no souls. Come on. There are no souls that you can reach. I've already reached everybody I know. I already talked to my brother, my sister, and my neighbor over the fence. I don't know if he heard me. But I'm convinced that every single fish is about to come. Every soul is about to come in the obedience of the voice of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And you may think that I've already reached out to people. I've already done what I could do. But I'm here today to tell you there are more fish in the lake. Come on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ooh, you get a revelation of this and this whole place will be packed. You get a revelation of this and we'll have to look for putting out more chairs and going to two services. Come on.
Amen.
And it's happening because this is the last harvest. We've already entered into it and things are happening. Come on, somebody. We need a revelation that greater things are about to take place. We need a revelation that God is on the throne and this is the day and this is the hour and you are the people.
Amen.
Glory to God. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. It says a number that could not be numbered of fish, and the net broke. And they beckoned to their partners. How many know that when you start getting blessed, everybody around you start getting blessed. Even if they wash their nets, they're coming out. They're getting blessed too. It said they beckoned to their partners, which were in the other ship, and that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, I am a sinful man, O Lord." Why did he fall at Jesus' knees? Because the fish were up to his knees. He didn't fall down to his feet. There were so many fish in that boat and in the partner's boat. They had never seen a catch like this. It was the biggest catch that anybody had ever seen. Matter of fact, Jesus said, from this day on, you will become fishers of men. In other words, you're going to go into retirement by this one catch. By the money you make from this one catch, you're going to go into retirement. Come on, somebody. Glory be to God. You'll serve me and walk with me and things are about to change. Why? Because they began to believe God, acted on His rhema word, and they began to see God working with them. Come on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, Kenneth Hagin and Smith Wigglesworth, they all prophesied about an end time revival that was about to take place. Let me tell you something. Everything they prophesied is happening right now. There are things happening, and you'd be blind not to see it. The things you see going on in the Middle East, the things you're seeing right now, the things, even when I've mentioned Kanye West and some of the things that people who would not even serve God are starting to serve God. Come on.
Amen.
I don't want just people who want to be churchgoers.
Amen.
I don't want people to just say, well, you know, that was a good message, Pastor. I want someone who just rises up, gets so fired up, and realizes the reason they were born.
Hallelujah.
You were born for such a time as this. This is the day and this is the hour. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 7. I love this. And as you go, preach saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick. Cleanse the lepers. Raise the dead. You know when it says cleanse the lepers, you know that there's been outbreaks now of leprosy again in California. And there's just been some things going on out there that just crazy. It says, raise the dead. I've told you stories of how the Lord's used me with that. And, you know, that especially that young youth pastor that got hit by a car. He was on a motorcycle, went 20 feet in the air, came down on his head. He was dead on arrival, they said. And they brought him to the hospital, ICU. He's laying there. I arrive at the hospital, straight line. I commanded life back into him in the name. And the thing started going bloop, 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 bloop. And all the doctors started running in there and told me to get out. I said, that's all right for, you know, all that, but well, look at this. It says, and raise the dead and cast out devils. I'll never forget, I was in my 20s and I was working with the original Full Gospel Businessmen, the original chapter, the one that Demas Shakarian started, and they had I had prayed for people and they got healed, so they put me up at the head table, and my job was to pray for people at the end of the service they had, and so different ones that would come in and I'd pray over them, and so many miracles and wonderful things happened in those days, and what a wonderful time. But I'll never forget one day they asked me, they said, there's a gentleman in the back and we need you to cast a devil out of him. I never cast a devil out of anybody. I didn't, what, you know? And you need to go, you know, now. Well, I you know, basically knew, you know, pray in the name of Jesus, use the blood, but hey, boy. And so they said, well, now go outside, go somewhere where, you know, you're not any disturbance or anything. So I ducked into the stairwell with this guy. Most eerie place you can ever go in your life. I mean, there was no lights in there, and it was kind of, there was one little glow of light coming in there, and there were several ghosts. And and this guy, and I started praying over him, and I thought, well, you know, he seemed all right. But then he starts foaming at the mouth and screaming at me how he's going to kill me. That did not go over well with me at all. And so I just knew what I knew, and I started praying the blood of Jesus, and he would fall down like a limp rag. And then a few minutes later, he'd come back up, foaming at the mouth, screaming obscenities, telling me how he's going to kill me, and I'd pray the blood in the name of Jesus, and he'd fall back down. Well, I tell you what, I cast several demons out of it. And you know, let me tell you, you don't need to name them. You don't need to do anything. Cast them out, bind them up, and get out of there.
Amen.
Stairwells are for climbing. Amen. But I tell you what, it says we'll do these things. Well, Pastor Jeff, that's the apostles. That's the apostles. And maybe their wives, the epistles. That's a joke. Okay, so, well, if you think that's just for the apostles, turn with me over here to Mark chapter 16. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. That's just for the apostles. Yeah, I used to love it when someone would say to me, well, you know, that was only for the 12 apostles. I said, well, what number was Paul? Oh, it was the 12 plus Paul. Well, what about Stephen? And you do realize that every one of them had disciples, and every one of them was learning this. Well, that's not for today. I'm sorry. If that's not for today, then salvation's not for today, because it's the same covenant.
Amen.
Mark chapter 16. And go down here. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 17. And these signs shall follow them that are apostles. Oh, it doesn't say that? And these signs shall follow them that believe. So in other words, signs follow believers. Did you hear what I said?
Hallelujah.
Well, I don't believe that. Guess what? You're not a believer.
Right.
At least you're not a believer in the signs and wonders of God and what God can do. And stop praying for miracles for someone that's hurting, because all you're doing is hindering them from receiving. You say, well, how's that? Well, so many times people will pray for somebody and they don't believe anything's going to happen.
Yeah.
And then when nothing happens, and then someone else prays for them and nothing happens, then that person believes God doesn't love them and God's not going to heal them.
Right.
And it had nothing to do with God. How many know God's will is that you would be healed?
Amen.
God's will is that you would be saved. Matter of fact, it's the same word. Healed and saved is the same word. Sozo in the Greek. It's the same word. Your confession of faith is what made you saved. Your confession of faith is what makes you healed. Your confession of faith is what gets you delivered. It's you believing God's word more than your circumstance. Hallelujah. You get that word in you and you just believe it and you become a believer.
Amen.
Amen. You might be a believer because you're saved, but how about you be a believer in all the book?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So it says, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Well, that's your opinion. No, that's the word. I'm just reading the word. You know what I love is I just go from verse to verse. And people say, I it's hard to argue with you that way. Because you keep using the word. We're a word church.
Amen.
I say, we're a word church.
Amen.
I'm going to keep you in that word because you can stay in that word. And I'm not talking about a word where you pick and choose what you're going to believe and you rip pages out. No, I'm talking about the whole counsel of God there. Our New Testament, our covenant that God Jesus died for. And you take that word and you put that word in you and that word rises up in you and you begin to be changed.
Amen.
Changed into what? The same image. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Turn with me over here to John chapter 6. Your Rhema word. At your Rhema word. You've got faith to move mountains.
Amen.
You've got faith that will move mountains. But you got to believe it. You got to believe God. John chapter 6, verse 28. John chapter 6, verse 28. Then said they to him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Now how many know? My text is that we are supposed to be doing greater works than Jesus. Amen. You read it. The disciples said, how do we do that? How do we do the works of God? Verse 29. Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe on Him whom He has sent. In other words, believe God. How are you gonna pray and see results even in your own life? You got to believe God. How are you gonna be a blessing to somebody and encourage them and give them hope if you don't believe God? It's God working in and through you.
Amen.
And it's time to do greater things. And we're gonna do greater things because we believe God.
Right.
We just believe God.
Amen.
We just believe His word.
Amen.
We're believers.
Amen.
Amen.
And
we're about to do the works of God because we're just going to believe we can. Not the fact that we're anything. We're nothing. We're as filthy rags. But Christ in us, the hope of glory. And that we're nothing without Him. But we're not without Him. We're with Him. And He's in us and we're in Him. And He gets all the glory. And I want to bring glory to God. That's what my life, if my goodness, if all your life, if your final thing is, you know, they have your funeral and everybody gets up at your funeral and they say, you know, that guy, oh, his whole life, boy, that guy, he could watch TV. And boy, he, you know, I mean, and they just, and nothing they say has anything to do with God. It will be your epitaph. It will be your legacy. It will be what people remembered. I want people at, well, I'm not going to have a funeral. I'm sorry. I'm going in the rapture. Hallelujah. But I want people to remember me that they saw Jesus. Amen. And they had hope. And I encouraged them.
Amen.
That's what I want. I don't want anybody to say, well, you know, that guy was really great back when he was in his Hollywood days and when he did this and when he did. Who cares about any of that? My goodness. I want people to say, you know what? That guy knew Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
And you know what I want Jesus to say when I get to heaven? Well done. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. What can we do? What can we do? Not confidence in yourself. Confidence in Jesus.
Amen.
Faith in Jesus. You plus Jesus can do anything.
Hallelujah.
You plus God is a majority.
Amen.
Come on. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You can put it this way. You can do all things, greater things, through Christ who empowers you by His Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Well, you know, this whole thing, you know, this is putting a lot of pressure on me to do something. I mean, I was going to a church and they didn't make us do anything. Matter of fact, we just got saved every week. You know, and we got to listen to nice music and it was a shorter service and we didn't have to open our Bible at all. But you're making us read the Bible and you're telling us what it says, and quite frankly, that's more than, you know, what's required. I want you to know everything that God has for you in your life is so wonderful.
Amen.
Everything He'll ask you to do in your life is glorious. And there's nothing better than to be in the right place at the right time for Jesus. When I go and pray for somebody at the hospital, I'm more thrilled than they are. Thank you, Lord, that You used me. Thank You, Lord, that they were encouraged today. Thank You, Lord. I walk out of that room with tears in my eyes because, God, You used me to encourage somebody that was down. Thank You. Well, how do you find the time? I mean, you're running over there into that hospital and going over here and going. We all got the same 24 hours.
Amen.
And we all have time to be used of the Lord. And let me tell you something. We're entering into this last day's harvest. And we're entering into a time like no other time. And it's time for us to see where we fit. And you may start with social media. If that's, you know, I can't talk to my neighbor. I don't even like my neighbor. He put his fence 1 foot over into my property. I will never talk to him. I think you should get over that. Because you weren't going to use that 1 foot anyway. And you know what? That particular neighbor, if they're in hell, it may be because of that fence. Life's too short to not see God's plan that He has for you. Hallelujah. And it's not just for the apostles, it's to those that believe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn with me to Matthew 17. I'm going to end here. Glory to God. Matthew 17, and let's look at verse 19. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, "Why could we not cast him out?" And Jesus said to them, "Because of your unbelief." You know, throughout Scripture, unbelief is always the problem. Jesus could not do very many miracles. What? Jesus could not do very many miracles in his own hometown.
That's right.
Well, why? It's just because of their unbelief. Now, a prophet's not accepted in his own hometown.
Right.
Well, faith is the core. And we need to establish ourselves in faith, and we need to move to the highest level of faith. Matter of fact, great faith.
Amen.
I make a good name for a church. Everything is about faith. Everything's about believing. Everything is about believing the Word, believing God, and believing that you have a bigger part in your life. There's a reason you were born. It says, "We couldn't cast him out." And Jesus said to him, "Because of your unbelief. For verily or truly I say to you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say to this mountain, 'Remove here to yonder place,' and it shall be removed, and nothing shall be impossible for you." Nothing shall be impossible for you. How can we do greater things? Because nothing shall be impossible for us.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Did it really say that? Yeah. Nothing. Nothing. Well, that was a typo. That was just right here. That was okay. Luke chapter 1, verse 37. "With God nothing shall be impossible." Luke 18, 27. "The things which are impossible with men are possible with God." Matthew 19, 26. "With God all things are possible." Matthew 9, 23. "All things are possible to him that believes."
Amen.
Say, "All things,
all things
are possible."
Are possible.
Because I believe.
Thank you, Lord.
That you'll use me.
For greater things.
Greater works. Thank you, Lord.
That I was born
for such a time as this. Use me, Lord. For your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.